Good morning. I'd like to welcome all of you this morning who come here to worship at Ridgeway, and welcome all those also who are joining us online. Are there any announcements this morning? Well, that's got to be a first. Okay, shall we come before the Lord in worship? Shall we stand for the call to worship? Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock of his care. Thank you. shall we come before the Lord in prayer? O holy God, like Isaiah the prophet, we stand now in awe of your glory, feeling tremendously small and polluted by our sin and the sin of our society. Even so, you touch us with your burning presence, and we are made clean and whole. O God, our Creator, continue to build this household of faith into what you want us to be. Our Christ, our Savior, lead us to do as you will. Our spirit, our power, strengthen us for the work of the kingdom, a worship and a service which is ours today as well as tomorrow. O blessed Trinity, fill this place and these people with your presence, for yours is the power and the salvation and the creation, now and always. Amen.
Thank you.
Unlike Mark and Matthew, Luke does not relate Jesus' Galilean ministry to the imprisonment of John. Rather, Jesus comes in the power of the Spirit that came upon him following baptism. Neither does Luke report Jesus preaching an eschatological message of the approaching kingdom. Luke offers the briefest sketch. Jesus teaches in the Galilean synagogues. The report of him spreads, and he is everywhere praised. If you turn with me to Luke 14, beginning at verse 14 through 21. I'm reading from the NIV version. Jesus returned to Galilee in the power of the Spirit, and news about him spread through the whole countryside. He taught in their synagogues, and everyone praised him. He went to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and on the Sabbath day he went into the synagogue, as was his custom. And he stood up to read. The scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him, and unrolling it, he found the place where it is written, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners, and recovery of sight for the blind, to release the oppressed, and to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." Then he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened on him, and he began by saying to them, "Today, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." May God's blessing be upon the reading of the gospel.
Oh, well, it's good to be back. See all familiar faces and some new faces. I'm glad to see. And, you know, when you come to Ridgeway, you can expect good music. And didn't we just have good music? Thank you, both the accompanist and Eliana. Beautiful. Thank you. So, what do you do as scripture is being read during Sunday morning worship? Now, some people do follow along in their own Bibles, fine. Some people quickly tune out and let their minds wander. Some people try to pay attention but get bored or lost along the way. Others might ask themselves, I wonder what kind of sermon the preacher is going to get out of this scripture text. Ideally, of course, the reading of Scripture should be a high point in any service of worship. If you ever attended a temple or a synagogue, you know that for Jews, the reading of Scripture is regarded as a holy event. The scrolls containing the Scriptures are priceless treasures. They are kept usually in some expensively appointed protective case and are then brought out to the lectern as part of the worship service. And some in the congregation, I've seen this, will step forward and ritually kiss the scrolls during this time. Why all the fuss? Well, there are a number of reasons. First and foremost, of course, is the conviction that the scrolls contain the Word of God and therefore are to be cherished and revered. In addition, the history of the Jewish people, an often violent and tragic history, contributed to the importance of the scriptures. Jews were forced to leave their homeland by the Romans, an exile that ended only after nearly 1,900 years had passed with the establishment of the State of Israel in 1947. And during that exile, as you know, Jews were persecuted for their religion in nearly every country they went to, culminating, of course, in the Holocaust unleashed by Adolf Hitler and the Nazis. Because they had no homeland, because their places of worship were often desecrated, even destroyed, Jews clung to the one thing that they could carry with them wherever they went: the holy books. Small wonder that the reading of Scripture is such an important part of Jewish worship. Now, by contrast, we Christians often assume a kind of a ho-hum attitude when Scriptures are read in worship. I'm sure none of you did that today, but, you know, it can happen. Most of us have heard the word so often, so we assume really nothing new here, nothing of interest to me. We're respectful, of course. I mean, no one talks aloud when the Scriptures are read, and we may even try to pay attention. We know that reading from the Bible is something that is done in worship. It must be done. At least the preachers seem to think so. So we at best tolerate it. But mostly, I think, people are eager for the Scripture reading to get out of the way so we can get on with the rest of the service. Now, maybe that's the way it was on that momentous day when Jesus came back to his hometown, Nazareth, and went to the synagogue to worship. It was his first time home after the baptism by John and after his temptation in the wilderness, and the word started getting around, as our brother told us a while ago, what he was up to. You know, he had begun teaching in the synagogues of neighboring towns, and people were excited by what they heard, the healings and all that. He was making a name for himself, and now he was back in the synagogue he had always attended as a boy and as a young man. Synagogue worship in the time of Jesus was a somewhat informal affair. The service did consist of prayers, a reading of Scripture, of course, comments by one or more male members of the congregation, and alms for the poor. There were no official ministers. An invitation to read and speak could be extended by the elders to anyone they chose. It was customary for the reader to stand when he read the Scripture and then to sit when he gave his commentary on the Scriptures. Luke's Gospel tells us that when Jesus, as we heard, stood up to read, he was handed the scroll of the prophet Isaiah. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where these words, I'll remind you again, are written: "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." Now, I don't know what the people in the synagogue were doing when Jesus read those words. Maybe some of them quickly tuned out. Their eyes may have glazed over. Their minds wandered when they heard these words, as they had heard so many times before from Isaiah. And maybe some of the listeners tried hard to pay attention, but kind of lost interest, got bored along the way. Maybe some of them wondered what Jesus was going to say about those Scriptures when he finished reading. But regardless of how the congregation listened to the Scripture, it was what happened next that got everyone's attention. Jesus rolled up the scroll and sat down, and then, as Luke tells it, the eyes of the synagogue, all the eyes of the synagogue were fixed on him. It was that hush, that pregnant pause, that shiver of excitement when comes, you know, when the orchestra conductor raises the baton, and when the batter stands waiting for the first pitch of the big game, and when the renowned speaker rises and moves to the lectern, you can almost sense the people leaning forward in expectancy. And Jesus looked out at the waiting congregation, no doubt waited a beat or two, and then said what none of them could ever have guessed he would say: "Today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." These days, a lot of time and energy is spent in church life dealing with questions. Questions like, what is the nature of the church anyway? How should the church be organized? How shall the church train its leaders? What is an appropriate way for the church to support itself financially? I mean, given that church attendance is down pretty much everywhere in our country these days, what changes, if any, should we consider for the church? Questions about church, and they're legitimate questions, appropriate questions for those of us in the church to keep raising and struggling to answer. But did you notice that all those questions about the church are institutional questions? That is, they focus our attention on the existence of an organization. They aren't really questions of faith as much as they are questions about an institution, about its well-being, even its survival. As I have wrestled with some of those questions about the church, I must tell you that I believe Jesus never set out to be the founder of an institution, much less the founder of a new religion. Now, anyone who claims to know exactly what Jesus intended is on shaky ground, of course, as I am today. But as I read the evidence in the Gospels, it seems clear to me that Jesus understood his mission was to fulfill what he was called by the Spirit of God to do. That is, to initiate and participate in what he himself called the kingdom of God, the reign of God. That's what he meant when he announced to the people in the synagogue at Nazareth that the prophecy of Isaiah was being filled today. It is coming to pass now, said Jesus. Now. As the gospel writer Mark records it, the essence of Jesus' preaching was contained in his short statement, "The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel." The mission that Jesus set out upon was an active, dynamic, disturbing mission defined by Isaiah, to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, and let the oppressed go free. Jesus did not say, what I want to do is establish an institution that will elect bishops, erect buildings of worship, hold conferences, and have meetings where people squabble about the budget. Instead, he outlined his understanding of a holy movement of justice and freedom he called the kingdom, the rule of God. He urged his followers to pray, "Thy kingdom come." Some years ago, Brazilian theologian Leonardo Boff offered his understanding of the church. The church, he said, is that part of the world that is, in the strength of the Spirit, has accepted God's reign made explicit in the person of Jesus Christ. That means that the task of the church in service to the world is to preserve the constant memory of the kingdom, to celebrate the kingdom's presence in the world, and to shape the way the kingdom is proclaimed. Now, in this definition, the emphasis you see is on action, not on organization. The church is a movement rather than an institution. And by this definition, when the church gathers for worship and for fellowship, as we are doing today, the aim should not be to make its members feel good about their religious experience, but rather to equip them for putting into visible form the kingdom of God in their daily lives, in the world they live in now. Now, I must tell you that I spent nearly all my working life in the church, bearing at least some responsibility for the way it is organized, trying to help it grow and remain strong, training its members to work together on committees and boards, helping to raise funds, doing many other things that have to do with institutional life. There were lots of joys and frustrations in the four decades I was active in the church. I have loved the church. I have been committed to it, and I believe in it, especially the Church of the Brethren, and even more specifically, the congregations where I served as pastor. But sometimes, I confess, I was guilty of thinking that the church was the essence of the whole thing. Because so much of my time and energy went into church, I sometimes forgot that what really matters is the gospel itself, the good news of the kingdom made explicit in Jesus the Christ, the one who said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me." The church should not and cannot exist for itself. Whenever we, in whatever church we're part of, get so caught up in maintaining, preserving, or expanding the church for its own sake, we betray the Christ whom we say we love and serve. This is especially dangerous because many people, even church people, think of religion and the church as a leisure time activity. Religion and church are something we do in our off time, our personal private time. Most church activities, as you know, take place on the weekend, where for most Americans, that's leisure time. In some ways, the early Christians had an advantage over us. Do you know what day of the week they met on for worship? It was on the first day of the week, the work week, at sunrise. And they did it before they headed off to their jobs. It was on the first day of the week they remembered their Lord had been raised from the dead, from the tomb, not on a holy day, but on an ordinary day of earning daily bread. The first Christians understood that faith must transform every part of life, not just what they said and did when they enjoyed worship and fellowship with other Christian believers. Church. In the same way, I believe you and I must understand that God's kingdom is not limited to our private lives. And we must understand as well that the essence of our faith is what goes on the walls, goes beyond the walls of a church building. God, the Holy Spirit, is at work in the church, yes, but also at work in the world. When Jesus declared his mission in that synagogue in Nazareth, he was addressing all the ills that plague human humanity. And when we pledge our lives to him and his way, we commit ourselves to confronting the great issues of our time: poverty, disease, injustice, racial and ethnic hatreds, the survival of the planet. At its best, the church helps us to recognize that all of life is holy, not just what happens when we gather to sing hymns, to pray, to hear the scriptures read. In fact, worship should prepare us to carry out our faith into the world of work and education and community involvement and family life. So yes, it is appropriate, it is right and good to come to Sunday school and worship, to have our spirits lifted and strengthened. Of course it is. But not lifted and strengthened for your and my sake alone, but for the sake of the world God loves. The world into which Jesus came to live and heal and teach and finally to give up his life for. And I can say that Ridgeway at its best has, for most of its 70-year history, done a pretty good job of living up to that word community. We could have done better, but we've done pretty well. I'm especially happy to learn of the outreach efforts this congregation is making in relationship with the Hannah Pantry, the offering of Saturday breakfasts, and even the possibility of using part of the softball field for a community garden. Yes. Yes. So to conclude, let me remind you of what comes at the close of Christian worship in most places, and certainly here. It's a blessing pronounced on those who have assembled. It's a blessing. We call it the benediction. And in some ways, I believe It's the most important moment in worship. As the people are sent forth into the world with God's blessing granted to them to be about the work of the kingdom. Now, frequently the benediction is phrased in terms of a charge, an order, go, you know, go. And then a blessing is given, perhaps with the words, and God's peace go with you. You may have heard the old story about a man who came to a Quaker meeting and was puzzled because everyone was just sitting there in silence. And so after waiting patiently for a long time for something to happen, he finally whispered to the person sitting next to him, when does the service begin? And the answer came back, when we leave. When we leave. It's still true. Our faith becomes real. Our service begins when we leave these walls and take with us the reality of God's kingdom as Jesus taught it and lived it. We go, and his Spirit goes with us. Amen. as you leave, take with you the blessings you have received in this place. Perhaps the words of a prayer, the face of a friend, music that touched your heart, and go to be a blessing, to be church to the people you encounter in the coming week. And may the peace of God go with you.